My name is John Kuperman. I'm an engineer at Bloomberg, a delegate on TC39, where I work on source maps, signals, and developer tooling. The Chrome developer tools have been one of my favorite pieces of software for over 10 years, and I love making courses to help people get the absolute most out of them. In this course, we will cover all of the DevTools essentials, like the console, elements, and sources tab. We'll talk about network optimization, look into CPU profiling with the performance tab, and even learn how to find and fix memory leaks. Take what you learn in this course and use the information to build highly performant websites and debug even the trickiest issues.
So, the first panel, the elements panel. This one hopefully is among the more user-friendly ones. So essentially it will have the HTML rendered as DOM on the left. And so you can kind of click through and you can see, you know, your elements and their class names or their IDs, different things like that. And then on the right, it'll have the styles that sort of attach to them. So you could click on like the body, and then you could see the body over here has the following styles, like its background color and color. These are all editable, they're toggleable. You know, you could turn the background color on and off. That might be a bit hard to see. Let's see if we made it red. And then turned it on and off. So they are toggleable like this. And they're also editable. So as you saw before, I can make the background color anything that I'd like it to be, and it will change in real time. There's a lot of information here. So like I think one of the best ways, if I cover anything too quickly or skip, to please raise your hand and call out, because I hope not to. But basically, you can see kind of the styles applied. You can see the file and line number that they're coming from. So I could go ahead and click on this, and it would take me over to the sources tab and show me where in the actual CSS this is coming from. Another really interesting thing is that, and we will cover this in the next section, but you can also, from the styles tab over here, you can click on computed. And I think the thing to know for now is that when the style engine receives multiple things that could apply to an element, it has this algorithm that it kind of applies to figure out which one should actually apply. I think the easiest example that most people know is the important tag exists. So if you have like all divs should be blue, all divs should be purple important, then important will win. But there's a lot of different things that happen here too. So if you're ever confused why a style is appearing, like if you see this is purple and you were expecting it to be something else, you can kind of come over here to the computed tab. We will cover this in more details when we do the elements panel, but it's a tab that I quite like, as well as it shows you the kind of box model. So I don't know who's heard of the box model before in CSS, but it's basically like an element has its width and height, it has padding, and then it has border, and then it has margin. So if you were to do like padding 50, I guess we could just, let's just jump in here. So let's like take an element here, and we will make a new selector for it. And so we say like, okay, feature details, they have like a width, or they have like a background of pink, right? And they have a width of 100 pixels and a height of 100 pixels. So that was like the most inner one. And then if you say they have like padding of 20 pixels, that would be padding outside of the width, but inside of the border. So then, 20 pixels. Then if you said they had like a border of 10 pixels solid black, now you can see that you have the width of the thing, then you have the padding, then you have the border. And then if we were to go ahead and say they also have a margin of 15 pixels, you can now see that the margin is outside of the border itself. So you see the margin is here, the border is there. I'm hoping you can see it kind of highlights these things. So we've got the margin on the outside, then the border, then the padding, then the width and height of the actual element. And similarly, if we went over to computed, we would see kind of everything that we typed here. So width and height are 100, padding of 20, border of 10, margin of 15. That is hard to read, so I'm going to refresh there. Cool. So you can do quite a bit here. Lots of things are interactive. For example, you can double click into a property, like a class property, and you can change this from main nav to foo, and then it loses all of its main nav selectors. So we can set main nav back on it, and it'll appear again. You can also at any time, you can right click and just edit as HTML. So you can truly add like a lot of things. We can get this whole navigation item as HTML, and we could add like a brand new, you know, li, hello, something like that. And so yeah, you can kind of edit around to your heart's content. You can edit individual properties, you can edit entire tags, you can edit the whole HTML block itself, all sorts of things like that. What we'll do for now is we will just kind of open the network panel and we will refresh this page here. And since this page has some images and some JavaScript on it, it's a lot more interesting than the page that we were looking at before. We can kind of see that there's like quite a lot of resources coming through and they're taking quite a while. We've got these low priority things taking a while to get through. I'll give it a second, and then I think I'll actually just pop this dev tool out so we can get a nice full page of it here. So yeah, so we can basically see that we've got these kind of screenshots of the app loading, which we showed before. I'm gonna minimize that for now. We've got a list of all of the things. I think Mark had pointed out this really great workflow earlier of like sorting by size and seeing what the biggest thing that came down was. So you can see that the largest things that came were our images, followed by this JavaScript file, followed by another image, and then we kind of get into our CSS and HTML. We've got at the bottom, again, still, we've got like how many requests we had, how long it took to load, and then we can see some things that are, you know, quite unacceptable, like the DOM content itself took, 7 seconds to load. The whole page took like 23 seconds to load. We can use this again when we get into the Lighthouse audit because it'll give us some really actionable items for making this load a lot faster. But the network is a great place to start off to identify that there are problems in general.
What would account for the differences in load times here? Mine says 3.21 seconds.
I think the big thing is that I still have this 3G throttle enabled by accident is probably the biggest thing. So let's go ahead and like refresh the page here. So now I've got 2.11 seconds. Yeah, it's a great question. I didn't mean to leave that on, but I thought it nicely illustrated that sometimes loads can be quite long. Cool. So we've got all this different stuff. This is a really good segue. These are really great tools, disable cache and throttling, but do make sure that you recheck them as you're going about through your day. I actually had quite an embarrassing, like probably like 5 years ago, I filed like a big like Sev1 ticket against one of our production apps for taking like an unbelievable amount of time to load and then realized I had like media, like fair 4G or something like that enabled, and I was doing all these profiles and I was like, how is it that this tiny JavaScript bundle is taking this long to, and oh man, that was embarrassing. So another case for using incognito windows because they'll reset all your defaults. But yeah, do make sure that these are so excellent to use. You can also do these cool network conditions that are like kind of interesting. So you can do like, you can like refuse some of the encodings, like some of the compression algorithms, you can override the browser cache, you can get like really nitty gritty with that. But I think just knowing that these network conditions are here is good enough for today. The one thing I wanted to point out here is that if we look at, so if we go ahead and we do a refresh here and we look at some of the times, so I'm gonna click on one of these scripts here. And so basically what I wanna do is like look at what took the longest amount of time. This picture took 11 seconds. Then I go ahead and click on it. We get this really cool, so similar to what we've looked at before, you can see the headers, you can see the image response and its preview and things like that. But I wanted to check out this timing thing because I feel like it's one of these like very underrated features of the DevTools. And what this is it shows you at what point in the load was this image queued for download? When did it actually start downloading? And then it shows you this really nice color coordinated breakdown of like very deeply inside the HTTP traffic, like the TCP, like where did things take a long time? So this harkens back to that like kind of superpowers I was talking about at the beginning, where you can see like how long did the content actually take to download? How long were we waiting on the server response? How long? And so you can do these really cool things. Like if, for example, I go back to google.com and I do a network thing here, you can really get like some amazing insights into, you know, what actually took so long. So we can see this, like, this thing took 3 seconds, and we can see that, like, it was really waiting for server response for quite a long time. You can get some really nice details into, like, you know, for example, like, the request started and it was told it was a secure request, so it does this HTTPS handshake and that goes back and forth, and then the request finally comes in. How long did it take before when that came in and when the first byte started responding? Maybe your server's slow. Or it took a long time to download, maybe the internet connection's slow on your user. So you can really see, like, you know, 3 seconds to load isn't the same as 3 seconds to load in different cases. It could be 2.5 seconds waiting for the server to respond because you need to scale your servers, or it could be 3 seconds all in downloading and the server responded immediately. It just took a while for the thing to download. So you can get some really cool information. I recommend if you ever strike anything puzzling in the network performance, you click on the asset itself and you come in here and you just take a little bit of a look because sometimes you'll see really surprising things. So we're going to be spending quite a bit of time in the sources panel because that's where you do the step 3 debugging. Let me close all this stuff out just so we're all on kind of a same even playing field. And if I look in the console, I can see that I definitely have some stuff that's logging to the console saying hello because I'm very creative. So we go into sources and on the left side, we see all of the assets that came down during that page load. So you can see my localhost application here and you can see it sent down CSS, JS, and a lesson. The lesson is HTML. So if I click through here, the JS is some code. I can step through here. And the CSS is that style.css. So kind of what we'd expect to see. So let's spend our time inside the JS file. And I tried to keep it quite simple. So we've got a set interval, and it runs every 500 milliseconds. And it sort of does this thing where it's got like functions calling other functions, because I thought that would be a nice way to visualize things. So the interval itself calls function one. Function one calls function two. Function two then calls a little bit of a split. It does like a math random. And if it goes one way, it calls three. If it goes the other way, it calls four. We feel all right about that. It's just basically a few functions calling each other. So we can do some kind of cool things, like we could set a breakpoint here on the if check. And we basically, if I hit play, it'll wait till another 500 milliseconds kind of goes through. And every time it's about to execute this code, it pauses. And the pausing will gray out the screen. It'll put this little kind of yellowy white paused in debugger symbol at the top, and it'll sort of activate this right sidebar. So for now, we don't really need this left sidebar anymore. This was just for kind of selecting the file. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to kind of hide it away. So we've got our source code here, and we've got the kind of like step through debugger over here on the right. And again, I'm just going to kind of minimize everything so to try to make it not as super overwhelming. So this is kind of our minimal case. We're paused on a line that we paused on. The application is not running. It is paused right now. We've got all these different options for things to inspect. And we've got our stepping options, right? So we've got play and stop. We've got step over. We've got step into, we've got step out of, and then we've got the generic step, right? And these basically do the same kind of thing. Like, we're paused here. If we were paused and we wanted to step into function three, we could click step into. If we want to step over function three, we could click step over. If we just want to go to the next line, we can click step. And if we're done with this, we can just kind of hit play and play it through. So some other really interesting things that come here, though, are while you're paused in this execution context, you actually get access to everything the app would have access to at this point. So for an example, is we can see in this function that it gets this variable passed in foo. And we can see this nice little handy thing. Chrome DevTools tries to fill things in for you. So it actually shows you the value of random number, the value of foo. You'll notice if I hit play again, it'll be a different random number because it's generated again. So you can see that the random number changes each time. But let's say it wasn't able to give us these things in such a nice way. We can expand this watch panel. And so what this watch panel will be is it'll allow you to add new things, and you can add anything in the scope of your application. So you could add anything from the global scope or from a contained scope or from this scope, like foo, and it'll show it. You can try to evaluate things like bar that we don't have, and it'll show bar is not available. We don't have that. So this is, again, all context aware. And kind of to prove that, if we go up here and we pause here, now we haven't executed this line yet, so foo doesn't exist at this point. So we can see the watch has updated. Now foo is undefined. So that sort of makes sense. So it is highly context aware from where you're stopped. The watch will reevaluate everything you're stopped at and kind of give you what it has access to. We move forward. Now foo is defined. So another really nice thing that we can see is the call stack, which is basically like you paused execution here, but how did we get here? And so for a contrived example like this, it's quite easy. We can see we're in function two, and it highlights we came from function one. Here's where function one called function two. That came from inside this anonymous function here, where it calls function one. But for a real web application, this can be really valuable where you know where you are, but you really want to see, like, for my full app load, how did I get into this code base? And again, as you click through the call stack, you'll notice the watcher updates, right? Because that watcher reevaluates. So here, foo was not defined. Here, foo was defined when it was called, and here, foo is still defined. So this can be a really nice way to, like, pause the application. Remember I said stepping is not time traveling, but the call stack walking is time traveling in this sense, right? Because it's captured that whole session. So if foo was not defined here, defined here, not defined here, defined, you can go back and forth through the call stack. You just can't step backwards in the debugger. So this is great. And then the last thing I kind of want to point out for this section is scope. So I know there's a lot of fantastic courses on Frontend Masters about how JavaScript works as a language and how scope works. And we've got these sort of different options with our vars and our lets and consts. We've got this function scope, all this stuff you can all learn on a separate course. But the cool thing here is that these dev tools put together where you are in the application. You're inside a function, and they give you access to everything you'll have access to at that line. So you can see the two things that we have access to are foo, which came passed in, and the global window object, which has all this stuff on it. But in a more advanced application, you could get a really nice insight here into what you had scope access to. Does that feel all right for people? Basically, it's kind of like putting together variables you would have access to at that point in time in the code base. Cool. Some other stuff to cover is this idea. So we've got these breakpoints. We've got a few different ways to set them. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to unset them by clicking on them here and play through the application. So one way to set them is to come into this sources tab and to click on a line number, and that'll set a breakpoint. And when that breakpoint hits, it will pause there, and I'll deselect it there. Another way that you can get there, which might be easier with large applications, is you can set them with this magical debugger statement. So if we go into debugging.js, and we were to come here, we can go ahead and start a new line and write this debugger statement. So these debugger statements will be a no op if the dev tools are closed. They won't run at all. But if the dev tools are open, it'll add a breakpoint there and it'll bring your user there. Now, lint for these, because you can deploy these to production and not know about it until somebody happens to have their dev tools open, and it'll just add these breakpoints. So these really do. Now, if we come back, we refresh the page, we see there's a debugger, and then as the timer fired, it stopped at that debugger. We'll be right back.